What's up, book lovers? It's Crystal, and today on Book Snob, we're gonna talk about our favorite young wizard, Harry Potter. Now, there's a lot of people who are major HP movie fans, but I've never read the books. I was one of those, so I set out on a journey to rectify that, and I'll be uploading videos about each book. If you're interested in hearing my experience, I encourage you guys to subscribe by clicking on the large red subscribe button below. What stood out to me most about Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone is just how accurate the movie represented the book. J.K. Rowlins did an awesome job of writing fantastical descriptions for a magical world, and although she seemed to have a lot of trouble publishing the novel at the beginning, I think we're all really happy that someone saw the greatness in it and that we have this series today. Of course, the movie did a couple things differently. For starters, at Harry's first meeting with Hagrid, Hagrid actually tells Harry a lot about his family. He doesn't want to tell him everything, but Hagrid has a soft spot for Harry, and he answers most of his questions about his parents. When reading, I was surprised at just how much the Dursleys were involved with Harry. The movie definitely made it seem as though Harry escaped them when Hagrid comes for him, and he never looks back. That's actually false. After Harry's birthday, when Hagrid gave Dudley a tail, Hagrid and Harry set off to get money from Gringotts, and they went to Diagon Alley to get all his school supplies. After Harry collects all his school items, Hagrid leaves Harry. But unlike in the movie, Harry goes back to the Dursleys for the rest of the summer until it was time to go to school. In that time, the family was afraid of him. They gave him his own bedroom, described as Dudley's second bedroom, and they did not speak to him for the rest of the summer. But Harry does, in fact, stay there after meeting with Hagrid. And Mr. Dursley even drops him to the train station when it was time for him to go to Hogwarts. Later in the school year, Harry receives a little money from the Dursleys, which he gives to Ron, who was entranced about muggle money. Keep in mind, the Dursleys did not do any of these things because they were kind. Actually, they treated Harry better because they realized that the magical community knew they were mistreating him. When Harry got his first Hogwarts letter, it specified his address to be the cupboard under the stairs. With that specification and Hagrid being able to find them in the middle of the ocean and give Dudley a tail, the Dursleys became afraid, so they treated Harry better than they ever did before. All of this wasn't shown in the movie, but I think that's an understandable storyline to omit considering the length of the movie. One thing that's also left out in the movie is the fact that Harry actually met Malfoy in Diagon Alley. Of course, they didn't know each other at that time, but Harry immediately knew that he disliked Malfoy because Malfoy spoke about how muggles should not be allowed into school. One other thing that surprised me when reading the book is that Neville seemed to be a bigger part of their little group than was portrayed on screen, and he gets involved in some of their shenanigans. When they first meet Fluffy, the three-headed dog guarding the Sorcerer's Stone, Neville is actually right there with them. Contrary to how the movie made it look, Ron and Harry seem to like Neville way more than they liked Hermione for much of the book, and Ron once gave Neville advice telling him to stand up to Malfoy's bullying. In the movie, they position Hermione to be a part of their little group much earlier, and they focus a lot on her as a major character, more so than Neville. In the book, both Harry and Ron really didn't like Hermione because she was such a condescending know-it-all. In fact, it is only after the troll attacks Hogwarts and Hermione lies so that they don't get in trouble that they all became friends. By lying to the professors, it was the first time she broke the rules. After that, she becomes a bit more relaxed about breaking school rules and being labeled a delinquent. And because of that, she becomes the Hermione that we know and love today. The story progression as well as the details were accurate in the book, and most of the magic we see in the movie was described in detail in the book by J.K. Rowlins. I was actually incredibly surprised that movie writers did not forego Rowlins' dialogue in the book to write their own. The book dialogue made up most of the movie dialogue. I don't think I've ever seen a book so accurately portrayed in the movie. It seems as though movie makers really did not need to put extra creativity or take liberties while creating the movie. I don't know about you guys, but I am honestly bummed that Snape refereeing a Quidditch match between Gryffindor and Slytherin never made it to the movie. It seemed lighthearted and fun, but perhaps movie writers wanted to chicken coop Snape into that dark and edgy characterization. Him struggling to referee a Quidditch match definitely removes the depth of such a characterization. Also, since there were two Quidditch matches in the book, one where Gryffindor played Ravenclaw and Harry's broom was bewitched, and the other one where Gryffindor plays Slytherin and Snape referees, it seemed that they wouldn't have enough time to add both Quidditch matches in the movie, and the suspicion of Snape was much more important to the mystery of the movie. So they essentially merged the two matches together to make one in the movie. Also, they cut out the storyline where Hermione and Harry sends Hagrid's baby dragon to Ron's brother Charlie to take care of. In the book, Malfoy did overhear their conversation at Hagrid's, but what he overheard was the plan to take the dragon to the top of the school roof at midnight to send it to Charlie. Instead of snitching immediately, he only tells Professor McGonagall on that night when the plan was in motion. When they handed over the dragon to Charlie's friends and they are on their way down from the roof, Harry forgot his invisibility cloak because they were happy their plan had worked. While they were on their way down from the roof, it is here that they were caught by Professor McGonagall, but Ron isn't with them since Harry could only fit one other person under the cloak. So Harry and Hermione actually gets in trouble, but Ron isn't anywhere there, unlike the movie. And finally, one of the biggest disappointments is that they cut out the entire scene with Hermione using her wits to solve Snape's riddle that was protecting the Sorcerer's Stone. Now, this isn't too big of a part, but the beauty of this part of the book is that each person, Hermione, Ron, Harry, play their part. Ron succeeds at wizard's chess, Hermione solves Snape's poison riddle, and Harry faces Voldemort / Professor Quirrell. Cutting out Hermione's part essentially lessens the effect of Dumbledore giving her 50 points at the end for using her intellect in tough situations to save lives. For me, since I've seen the movie so many times, but have just read the book for the first time, I imagine all the characters as the actors who played them in the movie. I think the casting was very accurate, but I'd love to hear from you guys who read the books way before you saw the movies. Did you agree with the casting and the actors' portrayal of the characters? Comment below to let me know, and look out for my other videos where I'll be reviewing the top 5 quotes in Harry Potter and the Sorcerer's Stone. See you guys.